inductive loads. The presence of an inductor of appreciable size in a switched circuit has a large effect on the switch rating. The effect of the inductor is to cause the current to rise to its normal value slowly than for a resistive circuit. So let us recall that an inductor are storage of magnetic field. Whenever a current is being applied to its coil, a magnetic field is being produced around it, and it is being governed by the right-hand rule. Once a constant magnetic field is generated in the inductor, it will not change any further. So that is the characteristic of an inductor. It will tend to make the magnetic field constant around it. As magnetic flux, which is equivalent to N multiplied by the current, inductor will draw a constant current to maintain the magnetic field around it. If the current changes, let's say an AC current that changes every so often, inductor will produce an opposing voltage, which is equivalent to negative N, the derivative of the magnetic flux with respect to time. And this equation is from Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, which states that a change in magnetic field denoted by the derivative with respect to time will give rise to an induced current. And this induced current is through the EMF voltage being induced by the magnetic field around the inductor. And this voltage will create or will produce an opposing current that will counter the change of current from the source. So that is how the inductive loads tend to cause the rise of current more slowly than the other circuits. For example, if we have a circuit that contains 0.5 Henry inductor, and the switch would break a current of 2 amperes in a time of 10 milliseconds. The rate of change of current, which is equivalent to 2 divided by 10 milliseconds, will be equivalent to the di over dt is equivalent to 200 amperes per second. So that the voltage across the inductor will now become 0.5 Henry multiplied by 200 amperes per second. And this is equivalent to 100 volts. Now, this value of 100 volts is comparatively small. But if the circuit is rated at only 6 volts DC, then the presence of a 100 volt across the switch contacts of the inductor circuit will cause a considerably greater amount of arcing because of the high value of DC voltage. Arcing becomes insignificant if the current carried by the switch is low, probably at milliamperes level and with a non-inductive load. But when we are dealing with DC supplies and inductive loads, then arc suppression cannot be neglected. So for this type of circuit, the most effective way of arc suppression is the diode suppressor, as shown in the diagram here. The sudden drop of current through the inductive load will induce a voltage that is always in the reverse direction to the applied voltage across the switch. And this is discussed through the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. By using a diode connected so as to conduct for this polarity of voltage, take a look at the diode here. It is on reverse bias with respect to the DC supply, but it is conductive with the polarity of the voltage that the inductive load will be inducing. So it will conduct current, and the surge of the current can be forced to pass a pulse of current back to the power supply and not onto the switch contacts. So instead of having to deal with a high voltage on the contacts of the switch, the current that is being developed through the voltage inducing the inductor is now being redirected to the DC supply. And most of the time, some circuits would employ a capacitor that is being connected to the ground so that the current will be automatically discharged and will not go back to the power supply. Diode protection is much less effective when the circuit operates at a higher voltage, for example, 100 volts or more, because the voltage across the contacts cannot be less than the supply voltage, and this is large enough to promote arcing. The arcing will, however, be considerably less severe than it would be if the diode were not present. Whatever voltage level is used in the circuit, the diode must be adequately rated both for the voltage and for the current that can flow. The flame proofing of a switch does not refer to protection of the switch against fire, but to the prevention of fire caused by the switch. And usually, this is being used for environments with flammable gases. The flammable gases on the surroundings will be cause of fire whenever there is arcing or there is spark on the switch contacts. And these hazardous environments are mines, chemical stores, processing plants that make use of flammable solvents. So for this type of environment, sparking and arcing should be minimized or eliminate if we can, but we cannot do that. So we are left with sealing the switch itself to prevent the spark to go out into the environment. Flame proofing cannot necessarily be satisfactorily achieved simply by sealing the switch, because a sealed switch can often have a very short life because of the accumulation of acids caused by the effect of sparking and arcing inside the confined switch. And this is an example of a rotary switch which is being sealed and flame proof. The common material used for sealing is a silicone rubber, because these type of materials are inert in nature. So this does not react chemically to the atmosphere and to other elements present in the atmosphere. Also, nitrogen gases could also be used in minimizing the accumulation of acids inside the switch itself. Connections to switches. Connections to switches may be made by soldering, welding, crimping, screw fastening, or by various connectors or other plug-in fittings. The most common here is the soldering, which can be used for low voltage and current electronic application. But if we are dealing with higher rated circuits and applications, then welded connections are advised. But the most common type of connections are the crimping types, and it has plenty of variations. This one here, this type of crimping device is the bullet type. So as you can see, it is a male one. So the other end of this switch connection is a female bullet type. So we will only insert this node to the other connection. And this type here is a blade crimped on connectors. So we have a male type and a female type. So we will insert this into the female type, and thus connections are being developed. But these types of connections are not the most reliable one because it could easily be taken in and out of the connections. Another type here is a screw fastening, which uses screws to fasten the connectors on the nodes. Now let's go to the non-contact switches. In other words, this type of switch does not use a mechanical system. These are applicable for low voltage switchings and can be carried out by semiconductor devices such as BJTs, FET, or thyristors. The switching of semiconductor devices does not depend on mechanical action. The main advantages of this type of switches is that it can be used for hazardous environments because the switch contacts are not exposed to the environment, thus corrosion and other material degradation are not possible. This type of switches avoids sparks, again because the contacts are inside the capsules and or inside the electronic device. The main drawback of these contactless switches is that the action generally requires low voltage DC at some point. Now, the control action of the switch may, however, need to make or break circuits that operate at a higher voltages, and this requires some form of relay action. Now, to address this type of situation, we could use opto-isolators, and this is a type of a relay action where one circuit is not physically connected with the other one. So when we can have a low voltage or low level of circuit here, and we can have a sensor, a light sensor, commonly phototransistors or photodiodes, which operates at high voltage level circuit application. So there are no physical contacts between the low level voltage and the higher one.